See, all of work in therapy or all of work with, in mental health is to create a safe space so people can be themselves. And the moment you can be yourselves, you've actually won most of the battle. No? Also because we don't have that kind of an understanding, because mental health issues can't be seen. Unlike like a fever, you can take a temperature and you know, or you've got high fever, you need to go to the doctor. Mental health issues, you can't see them because you just don't probably feel motivated to do the things you used to do earlier. Or you don't feel like talking at home, and so you're in your room, or you know, you don't want to be with people. So most people think, yeah, it's a phase, she'll grow out of it. Yeah, you know, her nature is like that. So we don't really need to address it. Oh, the SE hai. So friends also learn to adjust. Family also learns to adjust. So we all adjust around it, hoping that one day this phase will outgrow. And sometimes the phase doesn't outgrow, it just continues, and you know, because it's an illness, so it increases. And then when it increases is when people say, you know, how difficult in some iske saath nahi kaam kar sakte. Not realizing that maybe, you know, behind that difficulty there is so many other things. Like when we look at mental health, we don't only look at the social or the behavioral, right? There's a genetic component.
Yeah,
you may have a predisposition to certain kind of mental health concerns, and you may just benefit from going to a person who will rule it out and say, okay, you know, this is not genetic, or maybe you're living in a very stressful environment. You have maybe your partner, or you have a parent who's having really hard time, and that's how your mental health concern gets triggered. So. So what research also shows is that women access healthcare services later than men. They access it when it becomes very much problematic to deal with it. So it's acute. So when they come in, it's severe. Whereas men access any kind of health services earlier. And they come in with a large social support system. So if I see a man and a woman together, the woman is more likely to support the man in the process of seeking even mental health care, even if he is diagnosed with, you know, some severe mental health concern. She'll still be there, whereas the reverse doesn't happen. The woman gets abandoned, she may have to leave home, she's asked to leave home, she's beaten till she leaves home. Sometimes, yeah, I mean, it's not like a small, so the violence would be like, khana nahi do, usko bahut kaam karwao. So then automatically she wants to go away somewhere because you're not feeling okay here, you're not even getting your basic, like if you look at Abraham Maslow's needs, yeah. Even your food, clothing and shelter is not met, right? I've been having a lot more clients whose parents, when they come with bisexuality, saying, ye phase hai. I just had a child on Friday. His father's telling me it's a phase, and we accept it's a phase. He's going to outgrow it. And he's told me in therapy, I'm very angry. Mm. But I can't tell it because my mother is just crying, and there's so much of crying in the house that's happening, I can't take it anymore. So he's going to be developing mental health issues, and he's only 17. I have clients saying, oh, you know, thank God my mom's not there, but probably she wouldn't have ever accepted. So I think acceptance is the important part, because people are different.
Hmm.
Right? And also, if in a younger age, if I'm saying it's okay to be different, then anyway I'm building a healthy identity. So it's not only with the LGBTQIA that people don't want to accept, they also want to accept that teenagers today at 12, 13, 14 and 15 are more sexually aware and know about relationships and would want to talk to their parents about it. And if they don't have that safe space, they may access people who are not actually giving them the right information,
yeah.
Which is pornographic sites. Because then their understanding of sexuality also shifts, so then it's unhealthy for them. I've had clients who said, I have to not drink water because I'm impure. And she knows it because she's educated that she's not impure. It's her pure blood. She can't go in and so then that triggers stress. So every month around period, she would be so stressed, and ultimately she started getting anxiety and panic attacks. So that's how she came in therapy. But what we did is we did a lot of family work. And the moment we kind of did that, it just went. I've had people who said, I've never been to a therapist. I don't even know what to talk to. I mean, what is it so different from talking to my friend? I chat with her every day and it really helps me. Why should I come and chat with her? So, you know, the action part is what I say is a preventive mental health checkup. It's like when you go and, you know, you go and do a checkup for your blood sugar, you go and do a thyroid. If you have a known history of family mental health concerns like depression, anxiety, schizophrenia, substance use, any of that, do a preventive health checkup. Come for a preventive mental health one session of counseling. Sometimes that one session helps you recognize, oh, you know, there are issues I need to work in. Therapy benefits everybody. So the myth is that you can only access therapy when you're unwell. So when clients tell me, main pagal ho gaya tha, then tum mere paas bhi, main bhi pagal hi hoon, main bhi therapy le rahi hoon. Because therapy is for self-development. The moment you shift the focus that it's only for ill health, and you shift it, it's like going to the gym. You only don't go to the gym when you get cholesterol issues. Yes, there are people who do that. But all of us go to the gym and work out because we all want to feel healthy. We don't want to fall ill. Going for therapy, if we normalize it also, so I hate the word normal, but if we kind of make it more acceptable that it's as simple as going to the gym, I'm not going to get stressed. I can just go and do, like I was telling you, it's a preventive health checkup. Go see a therapist, maybe if something is disturbing. I've had clients who've come to me once and I've told them, you don't need to work with me, come when you have an issue. I've had clients who've come and need it, but they're not ready, that's okay. So it's not that everybody who comes in therapy is expected to stay in therapy. As a good therapist, wouldn't force you to be in therapy. Also, we believe it's a timing, no? It's like you only go when you're ready. It's like having a mirror. The mirror doesn't do anything. You just see yourself in the mirror. The mental health professional is like that mirror. I will just resonate back to you what you come with. Right? That, okay, this is what I see. This is a pattern. Because we're trained to recognize patterns. Right? And with a doctor, they're trained to recognize the symptoms. So if you're saying this is happening, they will give you medication. Because there is a neurochemical imbalance also which needs to be treated. So only when you work as a team, that the recovery for the client is good. So, you know, sometimes you think, oh, only I'll work as, you know, only do therapy, or the medical person will say, oh, only medication will help. No, it's a combination of everything. There are different kinds of professionals. Some of us have, you know, most of us have a basic training in psychology. Some of us have a degree in, say, psychiatric social work, clinical psychology, counseling psychology. These are the three essential professionals who practice therapy. And then you have psychiatrists who are medical doctors with a DPM, and they prescribe. In India, none of the other categories can prescribe. So there is a school which believes you need a test and then you again slot. The newer work, which is what some of us also do, is we look at functionality. I may be having depression, but you know, I'm able to cope with it and I'm doing fine. And somebody else has a migraine and can't cope. So it's functionality, which is what therapy has to help you achieve. Because what do I do with the diagnosis? I mean, okay, I have anxiety, now what? Teach me how to live with it. Teach me how I can have a better life. Teach me, you know, that I want to achieve this particular goal, let me go to that. That the diagnosis is not. It's not. It's much, much more visible. In fact, when I've had clients who come to you from outside India, they are like, oh my God, if this is how much it was. And of course, so again, it goes like any other practice. It depends on the area, your qualifications, your experience, and you charge accordingly. And of course, there are some of us, like I have a sliding scale, so you're charged according to your socioeconomic strata and not a flat fee. So for me, I have not had clients say that because I have that kind of an option where they can negotiate for it. Right? The because it's also a service where I want you to access it for a longer period. I don't want you to drop out because you get financially stressed.